That's
So, hello?
Works?
Okay. So, hello, welcome everybody back. Just take your seat. Still enough time, but we will start now in order to not run too much out of the tight schedule. So my name is Andrea Vetter and I'm from the organizing committee, and I have the great pleasure to facilitate this very last closing panel. So thank you everybody for being here again after 4 days of a lot of input, still more input. I'm always very impressed when I see this, because me myself, I never attend closing panels if I do not facilitate them because I'm too tired. So great that you are here. And we will talk a bit about a question: what can we take home from this now, and where do we go next? And for this I have three wonderful persons sitting here and talking to me. This is on the far left, Yorgos Kallis. He's Professor of Ecological Economics and Political Ecology at the Autonomous University of Barcelona. And he's a member of research. He's a member of Research and Degrowth and was one of the organizers of the Barcelona conference in 2010. Thank you, Yorgos, for being here. On my left, there's Lucia Ortiz from Brazil, and she is the program coordinator for the Economic Justice Resisting Neoliberalism program, which sounds great, I think, for Friends of the Earth International. She has a background as a geologist and is almost 15 years a militant for Friends of the Earth Brazil, and has done a lot of campaigning on important topics such as energy sovereignty, climate justice, and so on. We're happy to have you here. And on my right side is Christopher Laumanns. He is the press speaker of the Degrowth Conference 2014. Maybe you've already seen him as in this role. And he's also a press speaker of the Konzeptwerk Neue Ökonomie, which is one of the co-organizers of this conference. And welcome, Christopher. And he's also an activist for many years in the alter-globalization movement and also in the Spanish squatting movement and the right to the city movement. So first, I would like to have our three table speakers here to have a short input on a question: where do we go from here? What was, from your point of view or the point of view of your organization, the outcome of this conference, and how would you summarize your experiences? Christopher, maybe you want to begin.
So, thank you, Andrea. Before talking about where we can go as a movement, I'd like to look shortly at where we came from and where we are as well. So the first thing is the preparation of this conference. It was absolutely amazing. It was an amazing experience because this group that formed more or less out of nowhere and used grassroots democracy all the time was like a little home. We took time for decisions, for discussions of the content of the conference, and also for our feelings. Now, doing the conference was great as well, but a lot of work. There was loads of really encouraging feedback from a lot of people, and I'd like to thank everybody for that. In fact, it was so positive all the time that I rather doubt that it was the whole truth. So I'm looking forward to hearing what the feedback slips say. And at the beginning, people always said in this really surprised tone, "You all look so relaxed." And those comments over the days kind of died down. So what has the conference given us? I think one outcome of this conference is that the idea of degrowth has entered into the German post-growth debate. While the German post-growth debate has in part avoided discussing capitalism, at the degrowth conference in Barcelona, as far as I know, it was already stated that degrowth and capitalism as a system based on turning a sum of money into an even larger sum of money, that they're not compatible. And I think that's not a small thing. It's one of the things that we talked about in the observers group, which I attended to as well. Another thing that we talked about is whether this degrowth thing, whether it's a movement or not. And I think, yes, it is, because people perceive it as such, and because there's about 20 to 30 media articles saying that it is now, after this conference. But then people said in the observers group, but it has no clear field of action, and the objectives are really broad. And people were saying, this conference is very individualist. Like, people are flocking to the psychological workshops, and they're not so much going to the panels. And I want to say that I think this is a strength, not a weakness. That we know... we know we aren't perfect, and that we need to work on ourselves, on our mental infrastructures, on how we relate to each other. And that change begins in the mind. However, that's just where it begins. And there we get back to the question of the field of action. One of the observers, Tadjo Müller, he said that degrowth is speed dating other movements at this conference. So we had events on degrowth and feminism, degrowth and education, degrowth and climate change. And that, I really like the metaphor, so I'm using it, but I don't quite agree with it, because I'd say it's not speed dating. It's more the overarching character of the degrowth analysis, the point of looking into our minds and where we have those growth infrastructures. The fact that we're trying to get rid of the growth logic in our minds. If a logic of more is better and I have to compete to survive, is in my head, of course that's going to affect my gender relationships and the way I educate. But does that fit to the subject of degrowth and climate justice? Now, if we look at the IPCC reports, then we'll see that until 2015, Germany, for example, needs to cut greenhouse gas emissions by around 90%. So 90% reduction in 36 years. That is completely impossible if the economy is growing at the same time. So degrowth and climate justice aren't speed dating, they're married. And they have various open queer relationships and live in an alternative trailer park. So if degrowth is needed to save the climate, what can the degrowth movement do? Well, in 2015, there's going to be a lot going on. There's the COP21 in December in Paris. The French degrowth movement is organizing a camp for that already. And there's already talks of joining degrowth and the climate fights against lignite mining in the Rhineland. And the degrowth organizing team of this conference has decided that that is one of the follow-up projects that it wants to do for 2015. Which brings me to the last point of projects for the future. So I can't even imagine how many projects will start from here, from the open space, from the gap, and from all those little meetings of people that have got to know each other or have been in more conversations. I think one project that I'll do is watch videos of the events that I miss by sitting in that little egg-shaped cubicle all the time. One thing that we're also planning with the organizational group is publications. So we'll publicize books, collecting the knowledge that has been generated at this conference. And then there's this future project starting in about 3 hours. So after the collective action in the city, or the waiting room if you need more of a reflection of what has happened in the last 5 days, we're going to take the train to the local lignite-fired power plant and have a picnic, following the tradition of the picnic for degrowth, which says, change always starts with a nice chat around good food, and at the same time blocking huge carbon-emitting, land-eating, and wealth-concentrating infrastructure.
Thank you so much, Christopher. So today, you as an audience, you have the possibility to ask to this panel also some questions. Unfortunately, we don't have so much time, so it's not possible that everybody of you can ask a question, but everybody of you can write down a question on cards like this that helpers will give to you. And you can write them down as long as the two are speaking. And then the helpers will recollect these cards, and there will be people here in the front sorting them out. And so there will three questions be asked at the audience here. And the others can all be discussed later at the community platform, I think. So, Lucia, your turn.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you for everyone to come to the final panel. I think my role here is to bring some outside perspective from someone being very much welcome in this conference because of the organizers. A lot of organizers we can meet, they everywhere, every day, more and more of them in many different spaces, and also because Bund, Friends of Dear Germany, is part of these organizers. I would bring the perspective from the economic justice resisting neoliberalism program of Friends of the Earth International, with political objective is to build sustainable society by building people's power to dismantle corporate power, stopping corporate-led neoliberalism and globalization, and challenging the institutions and governments that promote unequal and unsustainable economic system. The aim or the targets of the program is to go into the heart of the political economic dominant system, namely the criminal corporations, the trade, investments, and even cooperations agreements that make an architecture of impunity for transnationals, and also the financial system, challenges the financial system that is grabbing nature and people's commons in an unprecedented speed. I don't know if you know, so it's good to share with you that Friends of the Earth International is a 40 or more years old environmental federation that today unites more than 70 organizations worldwide with a common vision for a peaceful and sustainable world based on societies living in harmony with nature, a society built upon people's sovereignty and participation, founded on social, economic, gender, and environmental justice, and free for all forms of domination and exploitation, such as neoliberalism, corporate globalization, neocolonialism, and militarism. We stand together to mobilize, resist, and transform. And indeed, the Federation has gone through a lot of transformation in these last 40 years, and in many times it was a big struggle, North and South struggle within the Federation, to come up with this process from the bottom up to build this vision together. We also had very nice observers that made a book that is called Environmentalism, Resistance and Solidarity, The Politics of Friends of the International, if you are interested. And now we are going to our biannual assembly in Sri Lanka. On, we want to reflect on concrete actions to dismantle corporate power and change power relations, to build people's sovereignty and ecological democracy, as well as to tackle patriarchy and discuss environmentalism within the class struggle. What brought us that far was very much the not only the speed dating, but more close to marriage or more close to really building alliance from other movements, a strategic alliance, but much more also from the process of being together in the struggle and solidarity with community defending territories in a raising context of criminalization, persecution, and violence. So no doubt this process has resulted in degrowth for Friends of the Earth economic resources, but in the growing of raising member groups in the South and also in the East Europe, and raising our capacity to respond to solidarity to the calls from the grassroots. Once I told you that I want to share it with you, I was told by indigenous people from indigenous leader from Brazil that there is a need for one to transform first, then to take the next step to be on service of the others. The same we can think about vegan people that, because of the consciousness, decide not to eat meat because of the meat production system, but then start to organize the amazing, wonderful kitchens outside, and they can do it for big camps, for big demonstrations, and also for emergency disasters of climate change, as well as for the families of political prisoners that we have from our protests. So it's like, make your transformation, put in the service and build the movement together. And the same is what I bring from the growth debate here, because I think that from the proposal of the growth in European context, now this reflection and this construction and building against the narrative, there is a lot of potential for much more alliance and making part of movements for climate change, for system change. As long as we see the need of phase out fossil fuel, as a need to move towards a post-oil and post-capitalist society, that the extractive energy model of production, consumption, distribution, and waste is very much linked and designed for corporate power and profit, that we need to dismantle this power. And we have to act to make people's demands and solutions concrete, that is, go far beyond and more radical than only doing individual or within one movement transformation. And of course, we have to speak out for peace and justice, no matter where the battlefields are. No war, no war. When Mother Earth suffers, we all suffer too. When there is war and military attacks, as in occupied Palestine, no one can be in peace. No one can be silent. No one can think that we can build a sustainable bubble. So having learning from this degrowth conference and from people here from different movements and initiatives, we see that we have shared many principles of systemic change and alternatives like justice, sufficiency, cooperation, reciprocity, harmony with nature, non-exploitation of any form of life, but we can go further to make the struggle to defend our territories, our common. To make the hope we can heal the earth and live well, a way to get free from fear and from the politics of fear. And to make the solidarity our main global good. So I would like to end call all these movements, inspiring movements from Europe, anti-mining, anti-fracking, anti-dirty energy, anti-useless infrastructure, and direct actions with the climate just moves ahead, not only to Paris, but starting now from New York struggles in September, then to Lima in December this year and in Paris, because this architecture of more dirty energy and more financialization is building on this space, is the scene of the crime, and we need to mobilize being on the spaces or from our own territories, being together, denouncing that. And finally, I would like to invite you to know more and join also the campaign on dismantling corporate power and ending impunity that has been proposing measures for a legally binding system to bring criminal corporations to to justice and give access to justice to affected communities and environmental defenders that are being killed by the corporation all over the world. And it's also a process that from the struggle of fighting corporations, we are sharing many and diverse alternatives from different sectors, movement, women, indigenous peoples, campesinos, environmentalists, to build alternatives to counter the corporate power. So this is my invitation for you.
So thank you for the invitation to be in this closing panel, and to say congratulations to the organizers on behalf of Research and the Growth, but I think on behalf of everyone here. And to say to Christopher that the feedback you got was accurate, there was no lying there. I think this conference was perfect. The only criticism I have to make is that it was too perfect. And I think in the growth and in the growth conferences, we need a little bit of inefficiency. This was too good. It was a very stimulating conference, and it was very energizing for all of us who work on the growth to be here and see so many people interested in it. Sometimes, you know, when you work on your own, you don't know if what you're doing interests or anyone cares about it. And I think not so much in Barcelona, because in Barcelona we were quite a lot, but I think for especially researchers in other universities that they work on their own and they are maybe the rogue ones in their departments, to come here and see that there are many people sharing the same ideas must have been a wonderful experience. What I want to talk about is to respond to the question of Andrea of what next, and I'll give my feedback, not what I think, but some things that I felt I took from the conference. Of course, this is a partial view because this was a huge conference and probably followed 100th of it. But I want to respond to two questions. The one is, what do we do next? And I mean, what do we do as the growthers? And the second question, which is more research oriented, is which are some of the open questions or which are some of the new questions that I saw coming out from this conference. So what do we do? I felt yesterday was a very fruitful day, yesterday's days, and I like a lot the way you organized the conference in 2 days that had some consistency of themes. So yesterday I felt there was a consensus on what we do. And it already emerged from the plenaries of Michel Bowens and Euclides Marseille, but I also followed some sessions on utopias and I saw the same themes coming out there. What we have, first of all, to do, and we already do, but we have to do it even more, is to occupy space in the economy. I think Euclides talked about it. This is by divert more and more of our time, and not only our times, but help others and together with others to divert more and more time away from the capitalist economy and from the wage labor economy to the solidary, peer-to-peer, or caring economies. In other words, to non-monetized and non-capitalistic forms, incipient forms of the economy. This is not only changing production forms, we heard, but it's also about networks of production and consumption. This, though, alone is not enough, and I think thus far we agree all with it. So we need also to make this possible, because if this stays just small innovations in very small scale, that's not enough. So we need also political action to let these new practices, economic practices, flourish. And what I heard in these conferences was political action of civil disobedience and direct action. We heard it from Naomi Klein in her plenary session, but we heard it also from others. Actions that say no to growth, to destructive growth, and they say no also to austerity. Some friends from Barcelona presented an interesting paper where they called these actions uncivil actions. against the civil, unlike the civil society, there are anti-civil society actions. The second political locus of action, I think, is on changing also institutions. And by changing institutions, we heard about new forms of democracy, already incipient from the Indignado Occupy movement of direct democracy. We heard about new policy ideas and new institutions of social security, like the basic income, work sharing, caps, leaving oil in the ground, etc. And we also heard about protecting what was the social security institutions that we had, and they are very quickly eroding under the crisis. The welfare state, public services, public goods, open spaces, etc. I liked what I heard in a panel yesterday, a citation from André Gortz, who called these non-reformist reforms. They are non-reformist in the sense that they are reforms that, in order to be implemented, the system has to change, otherwise they cannot be accommodated. And Massimo De Angelis have called them also new deals. He says there are new type of deals that they allow the new economy to flourish within a political space. But apart from political and just economic action, I think we need to do some other things too. First of all, I think we need also to relax, have some free time and leisure. The Right to be Lazy is a very inspiring group for the inspiring book for the growthers. We need to care for one another, and we heard that. 2 minutes already, okay. And of course, we need to care for one another, and we need to also depense, which is a word that we introduce in a book that we will be published by Research and Degrowth this November. It's called Degrowth, a Vocabulary for a New Era. And depense means just to waste ourselves without particular purpose. Mm-hmm. We need to do that from time to time collectively, and I think the party today is a good opportunity. But why I'm saying this is because doing all these things puts a very heavy strain on all of us, as it put a heavy strain on the organizers. And as Degrowth, we are against the division of labor, that far, that good. I mean, it's not that some people should do the caring work, others should do the depends, and others should do the political action. But on the other hand, we have to recognize that we are not hyper-intensive individuals, and we can't do anything. So I think we should also learn to respect those who put most of their time in doing the political actions, those who put most of the time in doing the alternative economic practices, and those who put most of the time doing the caring work. So I had two questions, but since my time is finishing, I'll stay on only one from the research questions, and then I think on the second round, I think I'll come on the second because it's a reaction to what Christopher also said at the beginning. But my first open question for research is, like, what surprised me a little bit and what generated the question to me is, how does degrowth travel or not travel to other geographical contexts or other cultures? I didn't agree with Sunita Narain's plenary discourse in the sense that I heard a lot of times the idea that the North should degrow, the rich should degrow, so that the poor grow. Arturo Escobar, in his plenary in Venice, made a statement that he said precisely the wrong type of framing. The question is this, that the North should degrow, so that the South grow. He said the North should degrow so that the South can find different ways and different trajectories to buen vivir. But the very idea of degrowth from the beginning was precisely to decolonize our imaginary from growth. So if we keep reproducing it with the idea that there is some poverty that has to be tackled with growth, we are reproducing the same mistake. Latus developed the idea of the growth coming out of the whole discourse around development in Africa. So it is really, really important, I think, for us to find new languages to express what has been done to overcome poverty, overcome destitution, overcome marginalization, but not use the discourse of growth. I heard in some sessions that the growth does not travel, that does not sit well in Latin America. Does not sit well in Greece either, does not sit at all well in the Anglo-Saxon world where people tell us it's an awful word, doesn't sound well, etc. And does it sit well even in France, where it was born, if you talk to anyone outside of the French activists, they will tell you, no, this word you cannot tell it to policymakers, et cetera, et cetera. So it doesn't sit well, but that's precisely the purpose of the growth, not to sit well. So if it doesn't sit well in Latin America, try to make it sit well. It's not the point to say it doesn't sit well in Latin America, so we should avoid the word degrowth in this particular context. That's the challenge. How do we make this word be relevant? Finish here.
Thank you both, Lucia and Yorgos. Now there's a possibility for you here on the panel to react what the others said, and there's a possibility for the people here in the front to sort out the questions in about 7 minutes. Okay. So somebody feeling like she wants to start? Great.
I would like to comment on what Yorgo said about different ways that we can find our own way, as long as we keep together and keep in a solidarity way and globalize the hope, globalize the struggle. I think that when we say that degrowth is a kind of bullet to dismantle the power of the ideology of growth, it is also to listen from the people in the ground what they are saying. It's also a very powerful tool for us to decolonize our mind and deconstruct also other concepts like development. Maybe one of the most powerful ideas the post-war that is racist because was telling that people on other countries, not in the center, European center, was underdeveloped. So it's racist word. It was imperialist word of the post-war as well. And this is so strong, and also our governments are defending development and also growth. But when our governments are defending something, it doesn't mean that is what people are calling for, no? So to have these spaces, to really listen to each other and see how are the narratives of people from their own territories, from their own lives, you can go much further than only anti-development or anti-growth. We can, and we have this generosity of indigenous peoples in Latin America say, this is the time that we are going to share our knowledge with you. That is the buen vivir. That beyond also many values that we are sharing here of reciprocity, solidarity, I think it goes even beyond that. I was talking to Christoph yesterday. When they say, hoy por ti, mañana por mí, that is today for you, tomorrow for me, is more than solidarity. Is that you don't need to fear, you don't need to accumulate, you don't need to try to grab everything and fear the future, because if you live within the community, you can trust and you can see that the others are going to be for you also. When you are suffering or you are in the struggle, you are in jail because of protests, because you are together with people in the protests and on the resistance. And this is also on the Ubuntu case, when we discussed the struggles against mine in Africa, for instance, they were saying, no, but we don't want this development, but we want to reshape and redesign and redefine development from below, and we can do it. But also, at the same time, they have the feeling that this feeling of solidarity and identity is that we see ourselves through the others. So it's learning from people, from the ground, from the different perspective, culture, diversity. It's something to be celebrated, and spaces like that are also for this, but also the struggles on the territories that need solidarity at the international level are also the place to learn from that.
So I want to react to 2 points. The first one is the point raised by Christopher about the relationship between the growth critique and the critique to capitalism. So I'm taking hot balls here, hot potatoes, as they say. So as Christopher said, since Barcelona, within the degrowth debates, we have gradually, but certainly, adopted the thesis that an exit from growth means an exit from capitalism. And Serge Latouche also has written this very explicitly in his book. But as Serge Latouche also reminds us, is that an exit from capitalism is not necessarily an exit from growth. And this is something that I think we have intellectually to work upon. Just to paraphrase a phrase I heard quoted from Slavoj Žižek, but I think someone else said it before him. He said, it's easier to imagine the end of the world than to imagine the end of the capitalism. That's not my joke. My joke comes now. So my joke is that for some people, though, I'm disappointed if I see that it's easier for them to imagine the end of capitalism than the end of growth. So, okay, it wasn't a joke then.
No, that was something that came out of the
conversation. No, but I think this is important to do too. And I think within the degrowth debates, we have learned a lot from the critical to capitalism debates. But I don't feel the same has happened the other way around. I don't see many people in the political economy literature taking inspiration, for example, from what we write in degrowth. And I think it has to work both ways, this debate, to be fertile. I see some hope because I read the latest book by David Harvey, a famous geographer and political economist, and in his last 2 chapters, he quotes and takes inspiration from André Gorz, who is the first person who mentioned degrowth and is the main inspiration for us. So I think the intellectual fertile ground is there, and I think it is politically important, this cross-fertilization, because as Haris Konstantatos tells us in his plenary, when he presented the situation and the debates in the Greek political left these days, there are 2 movements within the left. There is one which remains productivist and stuck to old ideas of growth and development, and another one which is the one which I think we are closer here, which is alternative grassroots economies, etc. So these theoretical debates have also political implications. I think we have to work also the other way around. Have time for a little bit more? Yeah. No? No, okay, but I think it's a good one, very quick. So I think this was an idea that a friend of mine gave me just before coming here. But I think we don't have only to think how do we talk to other movements, not only to people like us, but I think the key challenge for degrowth is how do we popularize the idea? How do we talk to the 99%, not to the 10 or 20%? And one way that I have found in Greece to do that is to link to latent feelings of tradition and of times gone, a tactical romanticizing, let's say, of, yes, we shouldn't be afraid of romanticizing. John Martinez Alier says that, and I think it's, sometimes you have to be romantic, but on purpose, not naively romantic, but linked to, for example, the traditions of the good old times, that they have something, and they are not only in Greece, they are all civilizations, all traditions in Germany have it. It's, let's say, the South, within the North, but not the South in the sense of the poor South or in the sense of the geographical South. It's the South, what is the alternative always to capitalist modernity? And it always exists and it speaks to a lot of people. It speaks to a lot of people the idea of simplicity, the idea of living well with little, etc. And to these things, I think we should focus, not just to our political and valid political goals as movements and linking with different movements. That's as important as building bridges also to the majority of the people. Yeah.
So, short remark from Christopher, and then hope they will be finished.
Yeah, very short, 3 points. Woohoo! We have a dissent. I think we have to be very careful about romanticizing the past because we can get very quickly get back into old gender relationships which are very, very unequal, and there we should be very careful. And not just gender, also talking about borders and the refugee problems that, or the refugee struggles that we have here in Germany at the moment. In the old times, they weren't a lot better. So, One short remark on, you said it was a perfect conference, Yorgos, and that's very flattering. I think you also mentioned where it wasn't perfect, the strain on the organizers. We tried to make it an ecological and democratic and social conference, not just for the participants, but also for us as a team. And I'm not quite sure how well we succeeded. I think you talked about the right to be lazy, and I think some of us need to learn how to be lazy again. Perfect. So less speed for less exploitation and less speed for better health, it says. That's one point, how to create a big get together and not put a big strain on just a few people. And the other is a very concrete thing on what Lucia said. You said that we need to stop corporate power in order to create the possibility of making a more sustainable and social society. And one option to do that is on the 11th of October, there's an action day against TTIP, the free trade agreement. And we, as the organization team of the conference, we signed the call for this action day as well. So you can inform yourself about that, the 11th of October, the TTIP action day.
So there comes the questions. I will already announce that we started about 10 minutes late, and I think we will take about 10 minutes more. So we have about 20 minutes to go now. I hope this is fine for you.
Okay, and probably we're not very helpful because our questions are not that easy to answer. We hope, at least, they're not that easy to answer. There were like 70 or 80 cards, and thanks a lot for all these suggestions what to discuss, and please understand that this will obviously not be possible. I was asked to make some short organizational points on the questions that we're tackling the next conference. There will be a call in December 2014, this year, for the next conference, which will take place in 2016. There's still a big need to evaluate this conference, and there's still a discussions whether there will be one huge conference or whether maybe it makes sense to have several ones at the same time. Proposals for the next place to hold the next Degrowth conference are welcome until February of next year. So these organizational questions are not to be answered now, but I will try to read one of our favorite questions. Isn't degrowth pretty unrealistic within the current geopolitical frameworks and constellations, where nations or alliances of nations compete for resources and survival and so on? So this is one of the questions that we're more or less going like, oh, the whole situation is quite screwed and there are so many enemies and they're very strong, and is this possible what we're trying to do? And we would like to mix it with a question that came up to ask for the people. That we need to be enough to put pressure on the political system. So how do we organize more pressure from below? Like, how do we get the critical mass? How do we get involved those people who are maybe not intellectuals on scientific conferences, that we all need to put the pressure for change? First question. Yes, I said it's not easy. Second question. Should we work on developing a new degrowth movement, like an own degrowth movement, or use the concept of degrowth to bring existing movements together? Understood? And the third question, which strategic alliances do you see or think we should seek? Which perspectives should be more visible next time? So, is this something you can work with? Good luck.
Strategic alliances. Is it an own movement or an umbrella term? So somebody wants to take up the challenge. I think on the first question with the how to reach more people, Yorgos, you already said some remarks. But somebody was.
So I guess on the question of reaching more people, sorry, because for my first time that I said, of course, I didn't mean a romanticization that would reproduce patriarchal or other oppressive relations. But this is also a tricky game, no? How do you take some things of the past? And that's precisely what degrowth is about. How do you take the good things from the past that they still exist and make them part of the future without taking of them also the bad sides of it? I will respond just to two questions. So the one is about the geopolitics. It's really something that I find impossible to think about because it's so much out of my mentality and way of thinking, all this race for resources and political games. And when I'm in Greece, I hear about Turkey now taking opportunities to do that and that, and Russia and the big pipes for oil, etc. Unfortunately, the reality is that the discourses are going more and more towards this direction. So I don't know how do we reflect on that as a degrowth movement. It's something to start thinking about. And perhaps if there is an alliance, is to bring people who start thinking along these ways in progressive ways that they are close to ours. If degrowth is a known movement, should become a known movement, I think we have to keep this core that we have here. But I don't think degrowth can be a movement just, let's say, separate from the anti-globalization movement, from other movements that they are around, from the Dignados movement, etc. No, that's not the point. I mean, the growth is an idea, it's an action, it's a practice, it's a political ideal that feeds in and inspires these movements. And people move one from here to there, etc. But I don't think it has to be a separate closed movement and it's we are the degrowthers, we do this, then we want also our political party, etc. No, far from that, or even without the political party part. I don't think the point is isolation. The point is creating a discourse, ideas, and practice that influences other actors on the ground.
Well, it's kind of hard to say what is the route that the growth movement should take, but once we identify ourselves with the growth, mean also system change and anti-capitalist struggle, you really fit in, or we really see you are much more than few people, or you are much more than 3,000 that are here, there are a lot of people. You are more than only from one Eurocentric perspective, because not only movements worldwide, we can say climate change, not system change, system change, not climate change, is a big movement, but the anti-capitalist movement, it's coming since the origins of capitalist people defending the commons. And I think it's something that really is strengthening us when we can really identify the root causes of the crisis that we are living and feel together in the process of systemic alternative and system change.
So I'd like to answer the first question. Isn't degrowth pretty unrealistic in the current geopolitical situation? And I'd like to ask back, what is your motivation for political action? Is it only success, or is it because it's just the best thing that you can do in the current situation? On the second question of movement or umbrella term, I have nothing to add to what Yorgos said. And the third question of which strategic alliances. So I think that degrowth as a term is, or as an idea, focuses on the whole economy and the whole society. So we should be looking at those things that are dangerous to the whole economy or the whole society and the whole possibility of even making politics. And there I see, on the one hand, free trade agreements like TTIP and CETA, which will lock in the current economy as it works, and therefore the whole destruction of livelihoods and the planet. And on the other hand, climate justice, as I said before in my opening statement. And there, specifically for the local question here, lignite is the perfect example because, or brown coal, as it's said in Germany, because it produces around 25% of the German electricity at the moment, the burning of lignite, but 50% of the emissions of German electricity. And it destroys landscapes and the homes of people. Around over 100,000 people have been evicted from their homes in Germany since the beginning of the German Republic to produce lignite-powered energy. So that is a very, very good focal point for the degrowth movement, I think a very good strategic alliance.
Just to add to what Christoph said, again trying to bring this international perspective, one thing is to shut down lignite open pits, and then it's not disconnected to shut down the plants, otherwise the coal or other fossil fuels can come from Mozambique, from Colombia, where they say that these corporations from Europe are social and responsible and take care of the environment. So it's really making the link with the struggles, as well as on the TTIP. Because we have been for years and years, for the last 20 years, fighting against free trade agreements. We have now agreements with Mercosur and the European Union, Central America. And also, why don't you fight out together to any free trade agreement against Israel? With our countries and Israel, as it's also working with. So we can learn from our struggles, including struggles that we defeated the free trade agreements of Americas, the area with United States. United States is also pushing the TPP, that is the Trans-Pacific, not Transatlantic, so involving Asia and Latin American countries. And it's the same model that the US is offering to Europe. Now Europe is like the victim, but the strength that we have to fight this architecture of impunity, we build together and then we can defeat them together. So it's not only a European struggle to fight the TTIP.
Maybe as a little addition, I always find it very striking how mostly people from outside Germany have a very clear stance on the whole Israel-Palestine conflict. In Germany, especially in Leipzig, this is very complicated. A lot of people don't take such a clear position on who is the oppressor and who is being oppressed. So maybe that would be, we said, another question was, which subjects were underrepresented? So maybe global geopolitics and the Israel-Palestine conflict would be two subjects. And I think if it's talked about, it definitely should be talked about in depth because it's a very, very complicated situation. And then, because this is a participatory conference, I'd like to say two other subjects that were said that were underrepresented. One is that the struggle of refugees, and the other one is I saw a note in the courtyard saying that the role of animals and animal liberation was completely underrepresented.
So thank you for your very short and disciplined talking here. I want to come to the very last closing round. Before I will say a short thing about the documentation of the conference, please go, if you are interested,
in any documentations of workshops or panels you could not attend, go to our website. There we will link a lot of video clips, a lot of protocols, and maybe also slides that was used in some workshop presentations and so on. You will find links to all that on our website. But we will only find them if you give them there. So people who did a workshop or people did not fill in the documentation formula, please do so. This would be great to make what you discussed in your what you discussed in your workshops would be great to have it all. Sorry, I'm a bit confused. So I want to start the closing round now. So there's, maybe we start from the left, if this is fine for you.
So to say, the organizers had asked us for the final round to give a few more practical reflection on what is coming next. So I will speak a little bit as research and degrowth, and we are mostly concerned with communicating the knowledge that is produced here to scientific audiences, also to lay audiences, but we are focusing also a lot on scientific audiences. So many of you here are researchers. What we did in the past is after the conferences, collect potential scientific articles and publish them in journals, in special issues. In special issues in journals that they were about degrowth. From the last conference in Venice, we produced also a book, which is coming out in November, as I said before. But there are many different formats through which people from you who are researchers can publish your research. But it would be important if, I think there will be coordination from the organizers here, but also if some of you are in sessions where you found four or five papers that they can go together and produce a book or a volume, to go ahead and do it. Of course, also publish your work on your own, but it's really important to change mentalities also in the scientific communities, especially within the fields of sociology, political economy, economics, etc. About the next conference, the logistical part was given, but what I want to say is that there is a standardized process where we make a call for, as research and degrowth, a call for conferences. We give the details of what we expect. Let's say we expect exactly what happened here. I don't think we have any more expectations than that. Maybe we come up with something more. But it's important to say that some of you, some countries that they are represented here, you might be thinking about organizing the next conference and after coming here saying, no way, you know, we can't pull up anything like that, you know, 3,000 people and everything working, etc. It's not necessary to have that size. And I mean, it could have that size, but let's say in the first conference in Paris, we were 100 people. Then in Barcelona, we were 300. In Venice, we were around 900, and now we are 3,000. So I calculate. This is a 300% growth rate. It's much more than the growth economy, and at that pace, in 20 years, we're going to have the whole world in our conference. But some of us don't like growth in anything, so Francois Snyder was saying, no, we can't keep growing this way, so I think we can have also some degrowth. So whatever happens, if there is growth or if there is degrowth, both are fine. So if you want, in that sense, in conferences only, in our conference, if some of you are thinking of a conference and think you can handle only a much smaller size, that's also fine. You know, we don't need necessarily as big a conference always. And I want to say that we are also welcoming the idea of regional conferences that try to reproduce a little bit the philosophy and the structure of what we had here. So if you feel, I don't want to do an international conference, but I want to do a conference in the Middle East, a regional conference in the Middle East, or a regional conference in the Andes, you can do that. Please come in contact with us, and let's try to coordinate and give you a little bit of our collective wisdom from past conferences. The call for the conference will be available in our website, which is, for those of you who don't know it, it's degrowth.org. And we have also a newsletter as Research and Degrowth, where we try to keep a network and inform everyone on the newest updates on degrowth, information, research, etc. So if you want to receive our newsletter, also go to the website and register. We don't want to lose you after this conference finishes, those of you who are new to degrowth. And finally, there will be also other conferences. There are conferences of particular scientific societies where degrowth is strongly represented. I am part of the European Society for Ecological Economics, and we are having a conference next June in Leeds. Those of you who feel you can contribute to this conference, you are more than welcome to come. And ecological economics is an interdisciplinary community. It's not only for economists. Don't be scared by listening to this term if you're not an economist. So it's open to geographers, social scientists, natural scientists, everything. But there are also other regional, other sectoral events. And sessions held, for example, I've heard in the Geography Conference next year in the US, there are going to be sessions on degrowth. And many of you who are in other societies, please organize sessions on degrowth on your conferences and invite also many people through the degrowth networks. Thanks.
Well, my final words is really just to congratulate all the organizers of this conference. I come from Porto Alegre, a city that after the mass of Seattle protests gathered a lot of international movements in the World Social Forums for many years. Huge people, a lot of very different style of organization in the Brazilian people. And we have a lot to learn, but a lot to thank, because we feel really welcome not only by the organizers themselves, but with the methodology of the gaps of the open space. What is this public pad? My God, it's something that it's amazing, and we can learn a lot from it. But also the interpreters, they're really amazing. Thank you, even to understand us that we don't have native language to share. And of course, the artists that make us think and make us feel much better and make us have beautiful times, and the amazing people in the kitchens. I'm really impressed with all the food stuff. Thank you.
So I just wanted to say that we didn't plan to make this conference this big. I remember that at the beginning we were saying 500 to 1,000 participants, and it just kind of grew. So as an encouragement to other people who want to organize smaller conferences. And then I've been asked to say that for the European Society for Ecological Economics meeting that you mentioned, the deadlines of this year, I think the first one is in October, and the website is esee2015.org, so you can enter papers there for the conference, which is in June 2015. And then there's this other date that I've been asked to say, and as I'm, I have to say that I'm afraid that I'm going to repeat what you said, and because I wasn't listening all the time that you said the date, so for it to be not that embarrassing, I'm just going to admit that I didn't listen all the time, because I was thinking about what I'm going to say. So that's the Citizens Summit in Brussels in this month, 23rd and 24th of September. Bang in the middle of the EU, and it's on overcoming Europe's growth obsession. And then the last thing to say is that there's a Solidary Economy Congress in Berlin in 2015, and they're looking for people to support them with the organization. And they've changed the name to Solidarity Economy Congress on Post-Growth Economy. But these are like all the big dates, and I'd like to say there's lots of small projects, and you know in which projects you're already in. There's struggles like those of the refugees. There's it's hard to choose. So choose your struggles. Don't try to do everything at once. And look after each other and have fun.
Cannot add anything better to that. So thank you, everybody on this panel, and I'll give back the microphone to Stefan.
Okay. Gut, oh, vielen sorry. Dank. Steffen? Bitte lauft noch
Kannst
nicht.
Du das noch mal kurz Feedbackbögen, habe ich gerade vergessen.
The feedback forms. Sorry, the feedback forms are currently being collected. If you don't have one, please go and get one. It would be really, really nice for many people to participate. Please stay. We still have a big finale in front of us, but we would like to give you some information for the afternoon sessions. And what we are going to do now is the following. You heard earlier that many people have helped to make this conference possible. So I'd like to hand over to Jo. Good afternoon. I'm actually quite intimidated to be standing here, but at the same time, I'm delighted as well. I'm delighted to be given this delightful opportunity now and task to do what I'm going to do now. In a few minutes, I will ask the entire organizational team to come on stage, and I will talk a little bit about the whole experiment of this conference. This preparation of conference started in January 2013 when people started to react on the call. In April, about 35 to 40 people came together from various initiatives who have taken up that experiment to organize this type of conference. So these people were members of young initiatives who tried to somewhat bring across the degrowth idea. Then what emerged from that was a decision-making body consisting of eight members, of eight plenary groups. So we tried to organize all this, and it was all a work in progress. It was an experiment because we know more the idea of democracy. We don't have the communication culture that we needed to organize this conference. Therefore, it was for us also a trust process and also to experiment, to try out how can consensus work in a good way among so many people. So I'll be very brief because we are already way ahead in terms of time. And I'm actually quite nervous and missing out quite a lot already. I'd like to thank all the organizations and people who've made this conference possible. Without them, this would have not been possible. Among them, these are also our supporting organizations, partners organizations. I'm not going to mention all the individual organizations. There are so many, and you'll find them in your program or on the website. Now, the speakers are also to be thanked. Moderators, the interpreters, and also those who are responsible at different stations. Over the last few days, these people worked so hard. Over the last days, they really worked together with us. And these station responsible people, they really worked with us together to make this possible. So we all had quite a lot in our hands, but we really tried to do our best. Moreover, I'd like to thank the many, many helping hands who always were ready to help. Thank you very, very much for your help. Well, I would now like to show you the faces of these people who, over a period of 2 years, have been working in the preparation for this conference. So I'd like to ask those who are part of this organizational team to come on stage.
Ja, wie Sie sehen.
As you can see, we are so, so many, and I'm not going to introduce everybody by name. You will find all the names on our website. And I'm not going to introduce all the different working groups. You'll find that at all on our website. What we're going to do now is what we've been doing for the last few days, just to motivate ourselves, just to boost our energy a little bit. Because we, as I said already, worked so hard. And what was really, really absolutely crazy was we were all amateurs. No profis as well are here. So we grew into our positions, and we really realized that our potential was much bigger than we knew at the beginning. And even though we did too much here and there, but we grew together as a group. And one of the things that we did every morning together as an organizational team, in order just to strengthen our focus for that day, we did the following. I'll just describe it a little bit, and then I'll ask you to stand up. So what you do, you hit your legs 7 times, and then you clap in your hands 5 times, and then you hit your legs again 2 times, and then your hands 1 time again. Okay, I'll show you. I'll tell you once more. So, and then after this whole clapping thing, you scream as loud as possible, and keeping in mind that what you believe. So it goes very, very fast, and the rhythm is really, really fast. So in order to create a joint moment, there's something coming at the end. So I'll ask you to stand up now. Yeah. And we do this exercise that we've been doing the last few days. So start. So we'll try 7, 7, 5, 3, 1. And if you want to jump, just jump and scream. So here we go. 1, 2, 3. Clap, clap, clap 7 times. Clap 7 times. Clap, clap, clap. Clap, clap, clap. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you all. Okay, Stefan will now do the final closing or give the final closing remarks. Okay, we are going to continue with more actions. I'd like to point out to an action that is available on your program. And if you go to page 98, there is a postcard right at the end of your program. We thought first that there are going to be only 2,000 participants just before we went printing. But now we are 3,000 people. So take out that postcard, and then you can distribute it all over wherever you go. Now we come to the actions that I'm going to talk about, and that's a big surprise. There'll be a big finale happening right now, and together we'll leave the hall. So stay for a minute now. At 1 o'clock, there'll be lunch. And what I ask you very kindly to hand in your headsets. There will be a demonstration, which is not really a demonstration, it's actually a parade. It will start at 4:30 under the title, Enough is Enough for All, A Good Life Instead of Growth Paradigm. And also not following the mess. So after the parade, there will be a picnic. The local newspaper wrote about it already and made some advertisement. They are actually a little bit worried because they've already started to put some police around. But we shouldn't be intimidated by that. What we're going to do, we're just going to go all collectively together. There is an anonymous letter that reached me, Flash Mob, and whoever is interested in such actions can come. At the Willy Brandt Prize, little billboards will be held up. So whoever wants to take part in this flash mob action should just join. So basically, during the parade or the demonstration at the Willy Brandt, you'll see that some people will hold up like little billboards, and it's going to be quite exciting. And for those who want to stay and not go to join the parade, and rather prefer helping the cleanup team, that would really be appreciated. It would be really nice for those who don't participate in the parade or who don't or prefer to stay here. I kindly ask you to just disperse a little bit, because it's we will need the space to clean up. Now for those who have a German program, there is a change because there's been a printing mistake. You'll have to look at the back in order to get information, because at 8 o'clock this evening there will be a party. The party which will start at 9 o'clock, there will be a concert with Captain Peng and Dieter Lax. It will start at 8:30. So you're all invited to come to the VAC to join the party. So before this party, there's a lot of actions that are happening, so we can all go together to that party later on. Now the cultural part, which probably has been ignored by some, let me just say the following. There is a waiting room. It's an interactive artistic event, which is also found in your program. You can find out more information from individual people. That will start at 4 o'clock and will go until 8 o'clock. There'll be also, it's from 3 till 7 o'clock. And that will take place in the Schulze-Dielert-Straße, which is in the eastern part of the city Leipzig. But you'll find all this information in your program. You can come and go as you wish. So now we'll come to the highlight, to the climax. I hope I haven't forgotten anything. Now, together, we'll have a joint action. We have planned a joint finale. And I was asked to say the following. Dear participants, that was the Degrowth 2014, and we'll now have a marching band. We will all leave the room together, and I'd like to thank you all.
Okay. Bravo! Danke, Europa. Okay.